He's not a councillor yet.
Sorry. He's from the Green Party, he's not a councillor yet.
But actually, let's skip the... I've seen you've got quite a long biography there. Okay. Skip that.
Okay, he's deputy leader of the Green Party since September 2014.
Thanks very much. So this section is essentially about policy, but I will be running in a few other things as well. I think that's inevitable, even though some may have stolen my fire, particularly in the audience. But actually, it's everybody's fire, and that's the problem. The points have already been made. And we don't like to just be oppositional in whatever we do, but sometimes one has to be. And we may have to look at what kind of other things that we want to be doing instead, of course. But I would say the quality of the objections fall into two main camps. First of all, this strategy is counterproductive on its own terms. So you could be condemnable from all sections of the community and as individuals that these unconscionable acts upon people who happen to be in the wrong place at the wrong time, they don't speak on behalf of anybody but their own sick, warped, depraved minds. And we need to pursue those as police actions. As we would in Ferguson, as we would in Minneapolis, these are not to be branded in that way, or we do the work on the behalf of those sick individuals. So we mustn't do that, we mustn't give them that, and that requires, of course, a contestation of ideas. So first of all, there's the counterproductivity of this whole agenda, and so if you agree with the end, then you wouldn't be pursuing it like this. And the second class of objections, if you like, is to do with the means. The end does not justify the means. If you were railing against injustice, as those of us across all parties do, you fight racism. You could ask, what's the Green Party policy on this? Well, it's very clear. We fight racism. We fight xenophobia. We fight Islamophobia, wherever it occurs. We fight for Muslim rights, irrespective of whether we happen to be Muslim or not. So, the end doesn't justify the means. Guantanamo Bay, incarcerating people for 14 years, Shaka Armour, for example, not even able to physically hold his son, who he had never seen before, uncharged, without trial. How despicable is that? The end doesn't justify the means. You can't pursue justice by perpetrating injustice. So where, as has already been pointed out, the top-down nature of this whole agenda is part of the problem, and it's an intrinsic part of the problem, because the very fact that we have so much opposition from the UCU, from the NUS, all these organisations speaking on behalf of their professionals and saying loud and clear, we can't put up with this. It doesn't even, there's no way we can pursue this agenda. If you're looking at the part of the educational field that we haven't touched upon so much is the universities. So it's said there are some elements of this Prevent agenda. For example, that the universities are exempt from. British values, apparently. You don't really have to worry about promulgating those if you're a lecturer, as such. And another aspect of this, which apparently the framers of this really ludicrous legislation, this sinister legislation, have tried to protect themselves from, is free speech. So we've heard about the Human Rights Act. We've heard about the Equalities Act, but there's also the 1986 Universities Act and the protection and the promulgation of free speech within our universities. And this does the opposite of that. What we're actually at risk of perpetrating, it's already happening on our watch, is that, and as lecturers are being asked to become the front line of that kind of referral mechanism to decide what looks suspicious, and I'll come to in a moment what those kind of training apparatus might look like, because I've actually attended one. I felt like a spy. So between these four walls, I mean, don't tell them. But I'll come to that in a second. But to actually try and shop on your students, who are, and as it's already been referred to in the schools, 14-year-olds trying to make sense of the world. And the Camden Council have already acknowledged that that's one of the things that you might want to do as a 14-year-old. Well, I'm still doing that. I'm still trying to make sense of this pretty messed up world that we live in. And how can you not try and facilitate that in the universities of all places? How can you not want to encourage contestation of ideas in a university of ideas? It is totally contrary to the whole ethos of a university to contradict those free speech aims, to say that, to try and do some risk assessment. And we know that trying to establish the truth in any matter is pretty much a full-time job. So how are we going to construct a risk assessment worthy of the name? No, what we need is for people to be challenged and their ideas to be contested on those platforms in the university without fear of persecution. So there is an insecure legal basis for this framework, especially in the universities across the whole sector. And what has happened now, the legislation is politicised. If a university refuses openly, overtly to comply with this legislation, then the Secretary of State, if she thinks that the university is not acting in accordance with its duties, she can direct them to perform in particular ways outside the judicial process. That is wholesale politicisation of how universities operate. In terms of the institutionalised, secondly, racism that this engenders, which has already been referred to, it's ideologically bankrupt, it's ideologically sinister, pernicious, as has already been referred to. And how does that work? So I've lived in Brent for over a decade. And, I mean, forgive me, but I would not ever tell anybody that they don't have rights, although I understand the spirit in which you said that. I would say that you have rights. You have rights, and you must uphold them. And when you are feeling oppressed, if I see a boy on a bus, as has happened just along this road here not so long ago, being detained by police officers, and the bus driver has taken upon himself to delay the bus for that boy to come on the bus, and he said to me, it's because I'm black. And I said, no, you must not resign yourself to that kind of oppression and treatment because you're black. You must rail against it, and I deplore it. I don't want to live in a society in which that kind of treatment is institutionalized. As, make no mistake, this policy would have overtly happened in the universities, because it is going to systematically oppress those individuals who, guess what, look suspicious. And when it comes down to training that I've attended, it's absolutely hilarious. I mean, I was giving, as I often do, I probably give people a hard time, and it was very difficult for me actually to sit through it. It was so full of stereotyping against Muslims. So I was asking, where are you getting this video material from, that your case studies? And it was all, the number one was all about Islamist extremism, not other kinds of extremism. It was Islamist, and I was told by this particular trainer that, well, she chose to do it this way. There was a kind of customized element to it. But really, when it came down to it, the Department for Business, Innovation and Skills had already produced these materials, and these really kind of had to be in there. They weren't customized to that degree. They were told, these trainers, often co-opted from previous, slightly less statutory prevent programs. So they're the kind of ambassadors, the champions, the co-optees who have been pulled into this. And again, that's an institutionalisation, because then their livelihood depends on it. Come on, you can't blame them, can you? That's all part of the institutionalisation. So we can spend $500,000 per bombing raid in Syria, we can't actually spend it in the places that matter. So we've got this training programme, which is overtly Islamophobic. It's extraordinary. So how do you spot the signs? Well, you tell me, what does suspicious look like? Well, I'm suspicious. I'm suspicious because I don't look suspicious. You can't win. No. I've gone through the border control, and I've got it down to a T. I know how not to look suspicious, but it's no win. I look suspicious anyway, because I'm not looking suspicious. So I can't win. So what are we actually asking for? At the end of the day, there is racial profiling. It's happening with Stop and Search, when he referred to. It's happening because people are identifying Islam. They're identifying Islamist inspired, not actually in the name of Islam, with people who look Muslim, like Josh Hastebenezes. a double injustice there, because he was wrongly misclassified by the police for being a racist, wasn't, and he was shot dead, as you know, in Stockwell Underground almost 10 years ago, just over 10 years ago, for being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Policy, shoot to kill, practice guidelines, in operation by the Metropolitan Police without any oversight by the community, without any due authority. Now, we're not saying that there can't be occasions from time to time when sharpshooters may not be required. That option has always been there. But when you change a policy, and here's an example of it with shoot to kill, when you implement a policy without the consent, policing by consent, long time since we've actually heard that, in the police, you will get these kind of mistakes occurring, where you've got somebody higher up the chain who's not actually at the sharp end, being able to make an assessment and just ask, by the way, do you speak English before I shoot you on the spot? When that's taken out of your hands and you've got this kind of top-down implementation, you are going to get these results and there is no trust. You must decouple the community cohesion element of the policy from the anti-extremist legislative element of it, if you can do that. So finally, it's counterproductive in its own terms. I've mentioned that. The authoritarian system of power is actually going to increase the desire for the use of violence, unfortunately. And you can look at the way that people are going to feel systematically oppressed, disempowered, unable to articulate and ventilate. And they're going to take them elsewhere. They may be able to find places in dark places on the internet where they will find people who aren't going to challenge them, aren't going to criticise them, and get drawn into, if that is although it's a debatable whether or not that is an actual scientific method by which you can get drawn into these ideologies. We cannot win on these terms. We have to redraw the terms. So yes, we are opposed to the means by which this policy is being implemented. There is no proper legal basis for it. Extremism also isn't properly defined. It's not something which, of course, the state can perpetrate. The state can't perpetrate it. So they've got a pass on this. They can do whatever they like with us. So we have to be vocal in this. We have to insist that, okay, our councillors and our wonderful shiny example of a council, which also already has its equalities problems and has shown itself from time to time to be not very good at policing itself. We have to insist, at the very least, that our £100 million civic centre is going to give over a few free rooms, yes, to us to be able to debate this, to make available the public space which at the moment is being systematically eroded, and the people and the students and the individuals are being undermined further and marginalised further, and it is institutionalising Islamophobia, and that's why the Green Party is opposed to it.